Hi everyone. So in the next series of videos, we're going to talk about the anaesthetic assessment and how to think like an anaesthetist when taking your anaesthetic history. So really, this is the bread and butter of your daily tasks and the foundation of your ability to extract vital details and be able to construct an effective plan. So what I'll do, I'll go through the general concepts in this first video and then get into more detail in the others. Now in reality, the first step is to review all the available history about your patient. And with the electronic medical records, it's really easy to review a medical or previous anaesthetic or surgical notes and all manner of consultations and investigations. So before I even chat to the patient, I often have a really good idea of what I'm expecting to find. So now in reality, the first step is to review all the available history about your patient. And with electronic medical records, it's increasingly easy to review a medical or previous surgical notes, anaesthetic charts, and all manner of consultations and investigations. So before I even chat to the patient, I'll often have a really good idea of what I'm expecting to find and what I will plan for the surgery. So I'll include a link to a pretty comprehensive assessment proforma, but here are the basic areas I really want to know about. So I want to know about previous anaesthesia and any problems the patient may have had, any post-operative nausea and vomiting, often abbreviated to PONV, and any anaesthetic problems that run in the family. I'll then ask about any allergies and the details of each, and then any medications that the patient's on and which were ceased or continued. Now the past medical history can have a lot of detail, and I try to focus on this particular aspect of each disease, which is the severity and stability of each condition. So in reality, cardiovascular and respiratory disease has the most impact on the patient's perioperative progress, so I'll focus on this in most of my patients. I then assess aspiration risk by asking about the length of fasting for solid foods and liquids, and also about any disease states that might decrease gastric emptying. I then examine the patient, and in healthy patients, this often means auscultating the chest to assess heart sounds and the lung fields, and then doing an airway assessment, and we'll go through this in more detail in future videos. So I then review all blood results, investigations, and relevant imaging. But at the end of all this, the real question is, what do I do with all the information? So if any medical condition is severe or unstable, I then proceed down a path of consultation and optimization. Now, for example, if the patient has unstable heart failure, I pick up the phone and have a chat or consult with a cardiologist to see if there's anything that can be done to improve this. If they have unstable asthma, I might consult with a respiratory physician, and so on for whatever disease process they might have. So I think about all the problems and see if there's a way to optimize them. Now, often patients are already really well managed, but I'm always on the lookout to see if they can be improved. And this could be as easy as giving an asthmatic patient some Ventolin before the operation, or something a bit more involved like, you know, tailoring the heart failure medication of a patient with severe heart failure. But essentially, optimizing the patient means reducing their risk to surgery to as low as possible. Finally, with an optimized patient, I now think about the patient and what kind of surgery they are having to then construct an anaesthetic plan. And more on that in future videos.
So I hope you enjoyed this video. Please check out the other videos on anaesthetic assessment for more of the subtleties when taking your anaesthetic history.